Motorsports. Ah, the beach, a summertime destination known for its relaxing, calm, peaceful atmosphere. But tonight, it's time for a bullring brawl as the bad boys of the NASCAR Busch Grand National Series duke it out as darkness falls over the Myrtle Beach Speedway. The Sandman tonight. Sit back and buckle up for the Myrtle Beach 250 live on TNN Motorsports.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. has won three times this year in the Busch Series. He leads in the race for the season championship. And here tonight at Myrtle Beach, he's starting out front. He is on the pole. Dale Earnhardt Jr. has a lot of laps on this racetrack. He cut his racing teeth here in the late model stock cars. And he's run well in the Busch Series. Will he be the Sandman, or will it be someone with a little bit less experience?
Mike, the winner could be somebody we've never even seen before. 19-year-old Ricky Hendrick, son of Rick Hendrick, has qualified his number 24 Jeff Gordon Ray Evernham owned car in fifth position. This is his first Busch Series start ever. Right beside of him in sixth place, 22-year-old Lyndon Amick returns to the Busch Series. After about a two-month layoff, he was fourth in this race last year, his best finish ever. And a couple of spots down from him is in eighth is 18-year-old Casey Atwood. We saw him get his first victory a couple of weeks ago at Milwaukee right here on TNN. And just a couple more spots beyond him, 18-year-old Justin Labonte. Yep, he's the son of Terry. He qualified their car in 11th position. That's better than Terry has qualified it all year. These young kids got great starting positions. They could make this thing very interesting.
To the Myrtle Beach Speedway, open at 11 o'clock this morning. In the 10 hours since, a record crowd of 17,000 fans have filed into this half-mile short track. This evening, the 19th of 32 races on the NASCAR Busch Series schedule, the Myrtle Beach 250 is coming up live on TNN Motorsports. Hi, everybody. I'm Eli Gold. Welcome to Myrtle Beach, a spot where everybody loves to come to. It's a great vacation area. The drivers love coming here because this is a short track. This is where many of the drivers cut their racing teeth, on half miles just like this, somewhere across the country. And, of course, the fans love coming here because they, too, love that short track racing, the beating and banging that is so much a part of NASCAR on the bull rings. And the competition here has been exemplary. Over the years, 11 times the Busch Series has come to Myrtle Beach. We've seen 10 different winners. Only Jimmy Spencer has managed to win more than once, and he's only done it twice. Now, as for the racetrack itself, that's another story altogether. The most important thing here at Myrtle Beach Speedway is the forward bite that the car has to get. The track has almost no grip, so the tires can spin very easily. You need to be able to turn in the center of the corner and not be loose coming off, because if you are, you can just spin those tires all the way down the straightaway and you've got yourself a long, long night. NASCAR Winston Cup crew chief Larry McReynolds is alongside. And Larry Mack, this is a tough racetrack to get a hold of. Have you had to deal with a track similar to this over the years?
Oh, it's quite a task. And up to the day, I never had been to Myrtle Beach Speedway. But during practice and qualifying, I went and stood down in the corner. It's not like it's like a track that we go to today, but it was like deja vu from a few years ago, North Wilkesboro. You don't beat people getting down in the corner. You do have to rotate through the center, but that's where your driver comes in. He's got to drive the car not only with a steering wheel, but with that throttle. Take care of those tires. Don't spin them. You're going to spin them. It don't matter what, but spin them as little as possible and have some tire left for the end of these runs.
And of course, Bud Pohl qualifying, as you'd expect, was very, very tight. 3/10 of a second from the pole winner all the way back to the end of the field. As a result, 14 big names have gone home. Details next. Set to fire the engines here at the Myrtle Beach Speedway for the 250.
Here's the president of Myrtle Beach Speedway Incorporated.
Billy Hardy is the president of the Myrtle Beach Speedway.
Start your engine.
Now let's check out the AutoZone race analysis brought to you by the more than 2,500 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. Yep, Pulsitter's done pretty well here. And look at the purse they're racing for. First time ever, over $500,000 on the line for the NASCAR Busch Series here at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. Now let's check out the starting grid for tonight's Myrtle Beach 250. The point leader with his third Bud Pole of the year, Dale Earnhardt Jr. The Bristol winner, Jason Keller. Randy LaJoy won here a year ago, and Phil Parsons' best start of the year. Rick Hendrick's son, Ricky, in his first start. Lyndon Amick back in the family car. Mike McLaughlin is eighth in points, and the Milwaukee winner, Casey Atwood. Matt Kenseth, number two in points. Tony Roper tested here a week ago. You heard about Terry Labonte's son, and Nathan Butke is in the 89 today. Hermie Sadler's going to drive that 33 car 10 times this year. And veteran Jeff Purvis, Jimmy Foster in his 16th career Busch Series start, and the 94 winner here was Elton Sawyer. Then further back, Ed Berrier, Wayne Grubb, Kenny Wallace, Hank Parker Jr., Brad Loney and Shane Hall. First-time starter, DJ Holzel. Todd Bodine is fourth in points. There's Butch Miller, Hal Goodson, Tim Fedewa, Matt Hutter. Those fellas are in on speeds. Now look at the names and have to use provisional starting spots. And Larry McReynolds, very interesting, because some of those guys were rather quick in practice, but didn't get the luck of the draw, I don't think, in qualifying.
Oh, there's no doubt. With qualifying starting at 6 o'clock under the sunlight, as the numbers got later, the track definitely got quicker. Dave Blaney used a provisional. He was actually quickest in the second practice this afternoon, so that just showed you luck of the draw did mean a big part of who started up front and who started at the rear.
We've got onboard cameras here this evening that'll be giving you a tour around the Myrtle Beach Speedway. Jeff Green, you saw him with a provisional starting spot. He'll be coming from back in 29th spot today. Veteran Todd Bodine will give us a lift around this racetrack that measures 0.538 miles, just a bit over a half mile around. Matt Kenseth, battling for the NASCAR Busch Series point lead. He's 139 markers behind Dale Earnhardt Jr. And the man who won this event a year ago with some late race heroics, Randy LaJoy, starting up front and third. He, too, will have onboard cameras today. As we mentioned, 14 drivers failed to qualify, and some significant names among the list. Adam Petty did not qualify. Glenn Allen Jr., Andy Santerre won the Busch North race a weekend ago. Larry, you and I worked that telecast in New Hampshire, and he's going home.
And you really thought, you know, that race built some momentum for that race team, built some confidence for Andy, but just, again, a tough race. You come in here, you're doing a one-day show, 2 one-hour practice sessions, you qualify, you line them up, you race.
And then tonight, Glenn Jarrett, as was the case at South Boston on TNN a few weeks ago, a bit of a wrinkle in the rule book for this evening's race.
That's exactly right, Eli. In the interest of safety for the crewmen that service these cars, NASCAR has mandated two competition cautions tonight. They'll come on lap 85 and lap 170. The pits here at Myrtle Beach are very, very close together, not enough room to do hot pit stops. So on lap 85 and lap 170, the crews will be given a chance to change tires. They can change four tires, put fuel in, make any changes to the car that they want to, send them back out. They got 5 laps to do this in. Once they get them done, they send them back out there in the exact same position that they came in on. So remember, lap 85 and lap 170.
And again, those laps do not count towards the advertised distance of 250. So we are set to go. Glad you're with us. On the flag stand, Johnny Norton. He is the chief starter. One lap complete. Dale Earnhardt Jr. having pulled away. Jason Keller, then Phil Parsons. Lyndon Amick in the 35. Battle between Atwood in the 27. And Randy LaJoy in the 1. That's for fifth. And there's Dave Blaney all the way at the back of the field. He had some problems going through the corner. Back of the field, Mike Dillon has a problem, and so too does DJ Hosel. All sorts of problems here on the going. Mike Dillon has a flat left rear tire, and DJ Hosel
comes down pit road to the attention of the crew. Not real sure. Looked like when something like that happens this early in the race, you almost question was something loose, like a line or something.
That's the scramble for the lead. Dale Earnhardt Jr. Jason Keller behind him in second. They've pulled away by about six car lengths from Lyndon Amick. Mike Dillon makes his unscheduled pit stop. Had that flat left rear tire. There's a good battle. Fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh position.
Side of Dale Earnhardt Jr. Looks like Jason's car was really right there, right through the center of the corner, all over the back bumper of Dale Earnhardt Jr.
This, of course, is Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s home track, and Jason Keller is a South Carolinian, Glenn.
Yeah, absolutely, Eli. You know, you guys were talking at the top of the show. Look where Jason Keller is down there. Below the yellow line, Larry was talking about how hard it is to make the cars turn here. One of the ways they do it is just what Jason Keller's doing there. Run the car down on the flat part. That kind of de-raises it a little bit. Helps the car to turn, get it up off the corner.
So in the early going, Dale Earnhardt Jr. shows the way here in Myrtle Beach. Jason Keller, though, wants the lead and makes it good on lap number 8. Jason Keller takes over the top spot from Dale Earnhardt Jr. The first of what likely will be a number of lead changes tonight as TNN Motorsports is live at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. Get a chance to experience country.com. It is your personal source for all things country. From race cars to country stars, you know the address on the World Wide Web. Country.com, that's TNN's home on the internet, your personal source for all things country. Eli Gold, Larry McReynolds, Glenn Jarrett, Mike Hogwood, that's the race leader, Jason Keller. Dale Earnhardt is running in the second spot, that's Dale Jr., and there's the third place battle. LaJoy, Amick, Kenseth, Parsons, all making their way towards the front. And Kenseth there on that 17 is actually on the move pretty well.
Qualified ninth, has moved up to fifth position. Talked to Matt this afternoon, you know, and they was really making a lot of wholesale changes on that car right before qualifying. And again, the thing, how you qualified the race car, the only thing you could change between qualifying and the race is some air pressure adjustments and pull some tape off the front end. You couldn't change no springs or anything to actually impound the car. But Matt told me, said, Larry, he said, we run so good on these flat short tracks last year, and it's like we've been struggling this year. We just can't get a hold of the racetrack, but he's on the move right now in fifth place.
Matter of fact, Matt tested at the Hickory Speedway on Wednesday in preparation for this race. Different styles of racetrack. They wanted to get some short track laps in. There you see in the middle of the screen, the 66. That's Todd Bodine. He's up to 20th. There's Jeff Green, started 29th. He's now running in 21st position. 43 is Shane Hall. Riding with Green right now. Heading up towards turns 3 and 4 of the half-mile Myrtle Beach Speedway.
Goes to the inside of Todd Bodine. Look at him all the way on the apron of the racetrack, below the white line.
That white line, the yellow line, they're merely for scenery, I believe. Just ornamental.
They just had some extra paint.
Yeah. Green pulls off the pass with Todd Bodine in the 66, shuffles to the outside. That's the battle for second and third as Randy LaJoy tries to grab second spot away from Dale Earnhardt Jr.
We saw it when Dale Earnhardt Jr. was running with Jason Keller a while ago. He's just not going through the middle of the corner. There you see Randy underneath him. This is over in turn two. Randy qualified third, moved back to fifth. One thing that might have happened at the start of the race for Randy, you start these races, especially when you know you got to go a long distance on tires, you start to
sometimes the car takes a few laps to come in.
Back into turn number one. That's for second place. 2.5 seconds behind the leader, Keller, and Randy LaJoy will make that pass. Now, Ricky Hendrick, haven't talked much about him. He is backslid now to 14th position after starting fifth, but not totally unexpected.
No, I mean, this is his first Busch Grand National race.
That's him in the 24 car.
Right. All he needs to do here, he needs to run as many of 250 laps as he can run. Seat time. You can test and test and test by yourself, but this is the real experience on this racetrack with some 30 other something cars. That's what's going to get you real experience.
Jeff Gordon was here earlier, as you see the battle for the third spot now. The Wolf car, number 17. That's Matt Kenseth, who makes the move around Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Well, that's a famous sight there, that three up in the bumper cam.
Sure is. I was saying before that Jeff Gordon was here earlier today. He and Brooke and Ray Evernham, of course, owning that car that Ricky Hendrick drives. And saw Jeff early in the day, and he was tickled. He said, they've got good folks working. They're going to be fine. And then he took off. He said, hey, they're qualified fifth. I'm going back to the house. And he's probably sidled up on the recliner right about now, hopefully watching our telecast.
And I'm sure he's told Ricky and these guys, again, the same thing we've talked about. You guys just need to go out there, be smart, try to run this entire race, get Ricky just as much seat time as you can. Don't worry about where you finish. If you finish this race tonight, it's a big accomplishment.
Jason Keller took over the lead at lap number 8. In the last 20 laps, he's pulled ahead by 2.4 seconds. Back to Myrtle Beach in a moment. Welcome back, everybody, as we continue here at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. The 32 is Jeff Green, all the way up now to 16th spot and challenging the 27 of Casey Atwood and the 53 of Hank Parker Jr. to work his way up even further. And Mike Hogg, what a classic example how a bad qualifying draw can really make the evening a tough one for you.
You're exactly right, Eli. This is what Larry McReynolds was talking about at the beginning of the broadcast. He went out early, right around 6 o'clock. This track was very hot. It was very greasy. He had a bad qualifying run. But this crew in the pits is very, very confident. I've been talking to them, and they have done little talking on the radio. Jeff Green hasn't been saying very much. They know they've got a good car. They know they've got a car that's capable of winning here tonight. They just told him to be patient and pick them off one at a time.
And indeed, he is doing just that as Jeff Green has made his way up to 15th position. Meanwhile, the leader is in traffic, the 57 Jason Keller, going around Mike Dillon, who had that unscheduled stop earlier for that flat left rear tire. But a lot of traffic now to deal with for the leader.
That's going to be the big thing. You know, we've run now 35 laps without a caution, and he's really starting to get in lap traffic. And talking about Jason Keller and Jeff Green, what we got to remember, these guys are teammates, and they look like they may have the two best race cars here. Jeff Green is actually only 7 seconds in front of the leader, Jason Keller, but the lap traffic's really going to be, I think that distance will really widen out here shortly.
Going way wide, you see Kenny Wallace had to get on the binders. You saw that smoke bubbling on up out of the Duraloop car. That's Kenny Wallace there in the 25, about to be put a lap down. Kenny's running in 29th position. Matt Hutter is in that red man car. Double zero is Buckshot Jones.
You see the one car just coming into picture there. That's the second place car. Jason Keller working lap traffic. It don't take long for the second place guy to catch him.
All right, Randy LaJoy is in that number one.
Randy was really happy with his car. This is the same car he had at Milwaukee 2 weeks ago and was so good until he had a flat tire. There he's all over the rear bumper of Jason Keller. Boy, I'm looking at these cars. I know it's night, but everybody's rotors are starting to glow. There you see Randy LaJoy's left front there. The rotor's starting to glow. You really use a lot of brake here.
You see NASCAR timing and scoring brought to you by MCI WorldCom. Your one-stop connection to the world. You'll see where your favorites are running. Finally getting around Matt Hutter in the 99. Watch what happened seconds ago. You like your beating and banging on the short track?
This is coming down the front stretch. Kenny Wallace dives to the inside there.
They had Buckshot Jones right there.
That was close.
Yes,
you saw Kenny had the wheels cut back to the right.
93 Dave Blaney also saw the opening there to scoot on by to the inside. side, back live now, working lap number 41. Leaders trying to bypass the 30th place runner, Buckshot Jones, in the double zero. Hey, Randy LaJoy, Glenn, just hounding him right now.
Yeah, Eli, he used that lap traffic, like Larry said, to pull right up on the bumper of Jason Keller. Randy really hasn't said much since the race started, except that the car is a little tight right in the center. Now, that doesn't surprise us. That's what we've been talking about all night. But it's one thing to catch a guy, another thing to pass him. But the tight race car, particularly right in the center, he's going to have to work awfully hard to get by that 57. But if anybody can do it, Randy can.
Well, let's see how hard it really is. Yeah. New leader. Nope. New leader, lap number 44. So Keller leads from 8 through 43. And Randy LaJoy, who won this event a year ago, now takes over at lap number 44. Only win last year for Randy LaJoy was this race. Of course, he is a two-time NASCAR Busch Series champion from 96 and 97. Folks, be sure to tune in to TNN tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock Eastern Time for race day. Complete coverage of tonight's action here at Myrtle Beach, plus the IRL race at the Atlanta Motor Speedway. Also, we'll have a preview of the kart race in Toronto. The NHRA is out at Vandermeer Raceway in Denver, and a preview of tomorrow's ASA race in Anderson, Indiana. Race day tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock. Mike Hogwood hosting. Rick Benjamin handles the play-by-play for the ASA race tomorrow. So the Hog will be in the studio tomorrow morning. And there you see Nathan Butke. Up to fifth place now, the car that has been driven by Jeff Fuller. And you can expect that Fuller will be back behind the wheel in future races. But Nathan Butke has the wheel tonight, Glenn, and he's up to fifth.
He's got a good grip on that wheel, Eli. He started 12th. You know, the interesting thing is, after the last practice, these guys had an engine problem and had to change engines. So they've really worked their tails off collectively to get this car to do the things in store for Nathan right now. I tell you what, he's got one of the quicker cars on the racetrack. Meanwhile, Dale Jr. is having some problems, Mike Hogwood. You hearing anything?
Yeah, I just talked to Tony Uring, crew chief on the car, and he said, hey, we've developed a push. The handling problem and Dale Earnhardt that he experienced in this race a year ago may have returned a bit, but Dale Earnhardt Jr. definitely having some problems getting around this racetrack right now. The car has developed a push.
Well, the thing about it, Eli, you know, that there you see it. He can't get down to the bottom of the racetrack through the center of the corner. We talked about it in the opening. Whether the cars turn in the middle or don't turn, you still have the forward bike problem off the corner, and a push just almost magnifies that forward bike problem because you got the wheels turned. There you see him, he got loose up off the corner off turn four there, so he's backsliding back to 10th right now, and I'm sure he's looking for this competition caution coming up here in about 25 laps where they can adjust on that race car.
He is already 9 9/10 seconds behind the race leader. There you see the NASCAR field standing update brought to you by Napa Auto Parts. At Napa, we keep America running. Dale Earnhardt Jr. having his hands full with the four of Jeff Purvis. The 33 is Hermie Sadler. That's right, that's Hermie in the car in that 33 machine. And this scramble right here is for 10th, 11th, and 12th. If you can't keep up with who's in that 33 car, can't say that I blame you. Jason Jarrett's driven it this year. Johnny Benson, Brad Leighton, Mike Wallace, Curtis Markham, and now Hermie Sadler. This is only the 19th race of the year.
The real problem Dale Jr.'s got here is their freight training. They got him hung on the outside, and there's nothing he can do but just hang on till the last car gets by him.
And can he get in front of Lyndon Amick there in the 35? He can. Here comes Brad Loney in the 90.
He can't. Whoa, a little bit of contact there between Brad Loney and Lyndon Amick. But Dale Jr. just can't keep that car on the bottom. And when you can't do that, you've got a long night.
He's back to 12th right now. Of course, this is Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s home track, as he calls it. Ran here for many, many years. Watching this battle in front of him for 10th and 11th. Meanwhile, up front for the lead, Matt Kenseth of the 17. He has caught Randy LaJoy. LaJoy took the lead at lap 44. We're now at 61. This is for the lead. Heading back into turn number one. They're closing in on Dick Trickle in that orange car. Bobby Hillen Jr. That's for the lead.
Boy, Kenseth's car really working on the bottom. Randy working the high side. Gets some momentum like he did there coming down the front stretch. Just depends on which direction Trickle goes, I think, is who's going to end up with the lead here.
Dick Trickle is in 22nd in the 5 car. The 8 of Bobby Hill, and he's 21st. And obviously, they're going to try and their darndest to stay on the lead lap here.
Again, besides just racing each other, the biggest problem these guys has got is Dick Trickle in front of them. But Dick Trickle, hey, he's trying to stay on the lead lap. He's thinking, hey, if I get a caution, then I'm staying on the lead lap. Same with Bobby Hillen. So it's not that Dick Trickle is doing something purposely here. He's just trying to stay on the lead lap because once you get a lap down, it's tough to ever make it back up. But I tell you, I'm pretty impressed with this Busch Grand National race here. These guys have run some 65 laps, and it's been a clean race. No cautions, not even close to a caution.
Plus, you probably want fresh tires after about 8 laps.
That's the thing. Again, I talked about comparing it to North Wilkesboro. The place just gives grip up. There you see Kenseth takes the lead there. Randy comes back, gives him a little bit of bump, but Matt's car really working good up off the corner there as they head down the front straightaway in the turn run. But yeah, it gives up grip. It's not that it gets looser, not that it gets pushier, just the overall car loses adhesion to the racetrack. And yeah, I talked to Randall DeJoy again, the defending race champion, and even though they can't only change tires on this lap 85 and lap 170, he says, hey, I want tires after about 10 or 15 laps.
I bet so. So Randy LaJoy settles in at second now, right behind that number 17. Now Trickle, you see, still right there trying to stay on the lead lap. Remember, folks, at South Boston, when we were with you a few weeks ago, Trickle qualified fourth and led 124 laps that day, led the most laps in the event. What a difference, though, a few weeks will make. As Dick Trickle, you can say he finally goes a lap down, but you never see anything with him.
No, sir.
Bobby Hillen is just ahead of them again in that yellow number 8. You're just tuning in. Dale Earnhardt Jr., Jason Keller, Randy LaJoy, and Matt Kenseth have shared the lead. And finally, Trickle going a lap down, and now Bobby Hillen about to do so as well. So the leader, Kenseth, in the 17, lapping all the way up to 21st in this race that has been caution-free. No cautions yet.
Finally clears Bobby Hillen. Carries Randy LaJoy with him as they go through turn 1 and 2. Bobby's still not ready to give up on Randy LaJoy, but pretty much Kenseth put some distance on him. Randy really beaten, but you can see he's fighting it there. His car looks like it's pretty loose up off the corner. You can see him fighting the steering wheel off turn 4 there.
Meanwhile, Ricky Hendrick, we had talked about him qualifying so very well. He's in that 24 car. The DuPont refinishes entry. He is back to 18th position in his Chevy Monte Carlo. But again, in his very first NASCAR Busch Series race, qualifying in the top 5. And he's done himself well, just keeping himself out of trouble and getting some laps.
And he's only 2 positions behind that 3 car, Dale Earnhardt Jr. So doing a very good job here on his first Busch Grand National race.
So Matt Kenseth, Randy LaJoy, and Jason Keller are front 3. We're just about 10 laps away from the first competition caution flag. We'll have that for you when we come back. Tomorrow, it is Inside NASCAR here on TNN. They'll be taking a look at how NASCAR teams cope with all the heat during the summer months. Plus, you'll see profiles of Ron Hornaday and Randy LaJoy. So tune in tomorrow morning at 10 Eastern and Pacific right here on TNN Motorsports for Inside NASCAR. Ned Jarrett, Stephanie Boyd-Durner, Steve Wade, and the whole crew. No change among the leaders.
No, but talk about lack of forward bite. That last shot there, Randy LaJoy up off, I think it was turn 4 right here a lap ago. He is really lacking forward bite. You know, those rear tires, they're completely gone. They're completely wore out. We're about 8 laps away from the competition caution, so I got to believe Randy says, you know, hey, I just need to ride here. If I'm his crew chief, it's like, hey, don't push the envelope here. We'll be in here. We'll get that thing tightened up here in a few laps, give you four fresh tires. And that's like the greatest relief in the world to those drivers, those four fresh tires sitting there.
And if you didn't catch us earlier, the reason for this competition caution that'll be upcoming in lap 85 and again at lap 170 is because the pit road here just not suitable for full-speed pit stops. Some of the teams pit on the back stretch, but only six of them. The pit boxes are very narrow and fairly short. They're used by the late model stock cars who run here on a regular basis, and pit stops are not a major problem. So that's why NASCAR will have the competition cautions. They will be five laps each. The laps will not count, and you'll come back onto the racetrack in the same position you went on to pit road. So a little less of the pressure-filled situation than you'd be used to, for instance, when the teams go to Pikes Peak International Raceway next weekend. Still Jeff Green quickest to the lot.
Look who's fixing to go a lap down if that competition caution don't come here in a hurry. Not only you see the 24 car there, but that car, that three, blue, he's almost a lap down, and he's got four or five laps he's going to have to try to hang on and get that caution.
Matt Kenseth is the leader, that DeWalt number 17. They put Ricky Hendrick a lap down in 19th spot. And you know Kenseth would love to put the man who's leading the points a lap down, because Kenseth is second in points, and here he goes.
Now there's this Dale Earnhardt Jr., his car, it won't turn in the middle, it's loose off the corner.
Bang.
He's not ready to give up. They bang fenders over in turn three and four, but Kenseth gets the momentum, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. here on lap 82 goes one lap down.
So they have lapped up to 17th place right now, the leaders have, around Casey Atwood in that 27 car. Couple of laps away from the competition caution, which comes at the conclusion, the completion of lap number 85. Pit stops are being made, however, in the case of the 33 car of Hermie Sadler. He just couldn't wait. And Hermie comes in to make a pit stop on schedule. Kenny Wallace in the 25 going yet another lap down. And here comes the caution flag now. Out of turn number four, the leader is Matt Kenseth, and the competition caution comes out at lap number 85. Teams can make whatever tire changes they want. Now, during a regular caution period, which we have not had any yet tonight, you cannot change tires unless they're totally flat and you're on the rim. Of course, under green, you can change tires however much you'd like, but obviously you'd lose couple, three, four laps during the exchange.
Right, yeah, that's the only thing. The only time you can really do the routine pit stop is under these competition cautions. As you said, Eli, it's five laps. What NASCAR asked them to do at the driver's meeting is, hey, you know, if you need three of those five laps to do your routine stop, don't get anybody hurt, don't get in a big hurry, let's use the fourth lap to kind of get everybody back in line. There's 16 cars on the lead lap, so that's a lot of lap cars to kind of sort out, and then we'll give the one to go and we'll go back racing.
Mark Reno and the whole crew right there getting set to service. Randy LaJoy, Matt Kenseth. He's facing another NASCAR Winston Cup event, and the DeWalt Ford. He'll run the Pepsi 400 at the Michigan Speedway on August the 22nd. He'll be also running NASCAR Winston Cup races at Darlington, Dover, Charlotte, and Rockingham. Later this year will Matt Kenseth. Hi, Glenn, here they come. The leaders are in under limited time constraints here, working the competition caution.
Yeah, Eli, Randy LaJoy brings the Bob Evans Farm Chevrolet into this pits. As I said, he's been complaining about the car being a little bit tight. They're going to change four tires. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment on Randy to try to get the car to turn just a little bit better, than what it has been. One thing about these competition cautions, you take your time, you make sure you get all the lug nuts tight, because you're going to go back out on the racetrack in the same order you came in. Mike McLaughlin, we hadn't said much about him. He's running fourth. Mike is also fighting a little bit of a push. They're going to make an air pressure adjustment on his car as well to hope that he can get up into the fray. Let's go to Mike Hogwood.
Matt Kenseth in the pits. He's just putting four stickers on and getting a full tank of fuel. He said he is good to go. Jeff Green, a little tight in the corner. He, too, is making an air pressure adjustment, trying to free that car up a little bit. Major adjustments on Dale Earnhardt Jr. They're taking a spring rubber out. They are taking two rounds of wedge, and they are also making an air pressure adjustment. They are throwing the book at the number three car right now in hopes that it'll run just a little bit better. There you see that wedge adjustment. Dale Earnhardt Jr., a little bit frustrated with this first run, but hopes he can fix that number three now.
man ran many a NASCAR late model stock car race here, but tonight's not his night. Right now, Matt Kenseth is the leader. We're coming right back.
You can just drive for Gold Bond.
3 hours in a race car? Man, you need Gold Bond.
Triple Action Gold Bond absorbs, refreshes, and soothes.
Gold Bond keeps me cool and refreshed. If Gold Bond works in these conditions, think what it can do for you.
Five M car was untouchable, winning the A feature. But the following night, just last night, bad news. A too close encounter knocked the front end off his car and caused a DNF. How will the 96 world champ fare tonight in the Mopar Parts Kings Royal?
Folks, you remember in Milwaukee back on July 3rd, NASCAR Busch Series driver Jeff Krogh was injured. Happy to say he's been upgraded to satisfactory condition and is now in a regular room at the Frederick Memorial Lutheran Hospital in Milwaukee. He is responding to verbal and pain stimuli. The Busch Series Ladies Association, along with Motorsports Designs, issuing all of those get well decals. They're on all of the cars here today. Lisa LaJoy is the president of the Busch Series Ladies Association, and she said we're keeping in close touch with the Krogh family, and certainly a lot of work yet to be done, Larry Mack, but the news far better today than it was when we greeted the folks in Milwaukee back on July 3rd and 4th.
It sounds like he's come a long way in 2 weeks. Certainly got a long journey ahead of him, but as we've said all along, our prayers and well wishes are with the Krogh family, and sounds like he's making progress.
Glenn Jarrett, Casey Atwood, all the way back in 31st, a couple of laps down.
Eli, I'm sorry, I was talking to my spotter here. We're down in Casey Atwood's pit, and you're right, he has fallen a long way back. Part of the problem is two things. Number one, they took big advantage of this caution period by NASCAR. If you're going to have five laps, why not use it all? They changed the right rear spring. Car was major league loose. Crew chief Kip McCord told me he didn't know what happened since practice. It's absolutely lost the handle. But one of the other things was Casey did not change his visor from the tinted visor that he used in practice in the bright sunshine this afternoon to the clear visor that they use for night racing. He couldn't see.
Now, we could call that a rookie mistake, but we do all of our practicing in the daylight at Bristol and Richmond. We run under the lights, and I've run around like a chicken with my head cut off a many a time trying to change that visor at the last minute because we forgot to change it. But sounds like they probably, if they've been that loose with that right rear spring, they've probably softened that right rear spring. You want to run just as little bit of right rear spring as you can in there just to get that grip. That helps that forward bite, that soft right rear spring.
Great crowd here at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. The competition caution winding its way down. Welcome back, everybody. The restart here at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. Matt Kenseth trying to keep Dale Earnhardt Jr. behind him. Remember, Earnhardt Jr. in the three is the first car a lap down. He is in 17th spot. Kenseth, the race leader. I asked Dale Jr. today, by the way, how are you feeling? That shoulder blade in Milwaukee. He said, just a little bit sore, but nothing bad.
You see him to the inside of Matt Kenseth down the back straightaway. Gets to the inside, gets the position.
That's to unlap himself. That's not for the lead, remember. The guy who's in second is the one car, Randy LaJoy.
Like Dale Jr. may carry Randy LaJoy with him. What they got to be careful here, especially in the case of Matt Kenseth. Of course, I know he wants to keep this blue three car lap down. As these guys racing this hard this early in this run, they are just using all the goodie out of those tires. And these guys back in third, fourth, and fifth, they're loving to see this right here.
Is that one of the terms they teach in crew chief school? Using all the goodie out of the tire?
All the goodie out of the tire. It's like throwing clumps of rubber off of it.
Mike Hogwood, looks like Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s made the pass on the tail end of the lead lap.
Yeah, he has, and I'll tell you what, Larry McReynolds' school of crew chiefs, that's exactly what Robbie Reiser and Tony Urie have been telling their drivers, the saying, guys, take it easy, take it easy. This is a long run. We've got to have those tires at the end of the run. But those two drivers have been racing each other now for a couple of years, and these fans are on their feet. And Dale Earnhardt Jr., as you said, does have his lap back.
But did they say don't use the goodie out of the tire?
But now I think Dale Earnhardt Jr., he did exactly what he had to do there. Saving those tires, being a lap down, wasn't going to do him no good later on. He had to do what he had to do. Here you see Randall Joy all over the back bumper of Matt Kenseth as they come down the front straightaway.
And don't forget the guys right behind them, the 57 of Jason Keller, the 34 of Mike McLaughlin. They're battling for position. Jeff Green in the 32 is up to fifth. Nathan Butke still running sixth. Brad Loney, fine run in seventh. So a lot of interesting names up there. Tony Roper knocking on the door of the top 10.
I tell you, we talk about Jeff Green in fifth. Of course, the further you go, the harder it gets, but that's pretty impressive. An 80-something lap from 29th to 5th on a short track.
Short track.
Under Green, no cautions to help catch him up.
There is Jeff Green in the 32. The 5 is Trickle. He's a lap down in 19th.
Jeff Green's car really working good. Pulls it right down below the yellow line, almost against the guardrail through turn 1 and 2.
Jeff Green thought he had a victory in Milwaukee a couple of weekends ago. Casey Atwood then rooted him out of the way on the final turn of the final lap to grab the win.
Trying to make the pass on Dick Trickle again. Trickle a lap down here on lap 95.
Just tuning in, only one driver done for the night. First-time starter DJ Holzel lost an engine on lap number 3. And that has been it. There was no caution associated with it. He got the car wowed down, stayed on the apron of the track, and went to the garage, and that has been it. We have had no bona fide cautions. We have had the competition caution at lap 85, but no incidents on the racetrack to bring out a caution. And we're now at lap number 99. That's first, second, and third. Kenseth, LaJoy, and Keller. All of those drivers have led the event at times tonight.
Randy give Matt just a little bit of a kiss off turn 4, pulls it inside, headed into turn 1. Randy all the way below the white line, going to make the pass, going up the front straightaway. Jason Keller trying to go with him, gets a little loose off turn 2.
That's for the lead coming up to lap number 100. At the stripe, Glenn virtually a dead heat.
Yeah, Eli, I tell you what, the guys down here in LaJoy's pits, they haven't had a whole lot to cheer about lately, but he loves this racetrack as he takes the lead right there. But there is some concern as well. Car owner James Fitch told me a while ago, right after that mandatory caution, that on the start of the race, Randy started third, he missed a gear, and they saw a little puff of smoke come out of the engine. So they're just kind of walking around here on pins and needles, hoping that he didn't stretch something in the valve train that might cause engine problems later on. No problems right now, but I tell you, they're worried.
So time will tell. While there's a problem in turn number 4, that is Tim Fedewa, who was the pole sitter a year ago, spins the Stanley Pontiac out of turn number 4. That is the second caution of the day. He's in 29th spot, Fedewa is. The caution flies at lap number 102, and there goes the right rear.
And guess who makes their lap up? Dale
Earnhardt Jr.
Now he's got a long way to go. He's going to be back in 17th, but he is back on the lead lap here.
So Tim Fedewa spins off turn number 4. Dale Earnhardt Jr. gets his lap back, and he will become the 17th different driver to join the lead lap. And how did he get there? Remember what happened just a short while ago. Dale Earnhardt Jr. was battling with Matt Kenseth, trying to get his lap back. And he did here at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. Getting set to go back to green. Dale Earnhardt Jr. was in moments ago. Larry McReynolds for this pit stop.
Now, again, you can come in under caution, make adjustments. They're working on the front end of the car right here. You saw the nose was caved in just a little while ago. They're not changing tires, so everything they're doing here is perfectly legal. I think we also saw a guy go to the right rear. You saw the air hose there. He actually put some air in the right rear. As we go back to racing here on lap 106, that increases the right rear spring rate. That tells me that car is still pushing, not turning. So they put air in the right rear to try to make it turn. The only fear on that would be that on a long run, that would hurt your forward body.
Tony Urey making those changes, seeing what they can do to get Dale Earnhardt Jr., now that he's back on the lead lap, a bit more competitive than he's been. We're at lap 106. The next competition caution comes up at lap 170. There's Dale Earnhardt Jr. And Mike Hogwood. I guess they're rolling the dice, but they want to try something.
Well, everything they threw at it in the competition caution worked, except Dale Jr. said the car was still a little bit tight in the center of the corner. So they did just what Larry McReynolds said. They put 1 pound of air pressure into the right rear, and hopefully that'll really make this car take off.
Unscheduled pit stop underway for Ed Berrier at lap 108. If you're a fan of his, Ed is in 29th spot, making an unscheduled pit stop. That's the separation, first to second, LaJoie and Kenseth. Then Jeff Green, Jason Keller, Mike McLaughlin rounds out the top five. Ricky Hendrick, we followed him. The tail around goes Earnhardt Jr. The soft spin right through the picture frame. No contact, no caution. No contact, no caution.
There you see the leaders coming off turn four, so he lost a lot of ground. And again, the racetrack did stay green.
So Dale Earnhardt Jr. spun at lap 111, and there he continues on. I was going to say that Ricky Hendrick's running back in 21st spot now, a lap down. We've been following his storyline throughout the course of the night.
The biggest thing is Dale Earnhardt Jr. spun on the front stretch is that he didn't flat spot those tires, lock the brakes up, because if you do that, that runs that set of tires. So it'll be interesting to see how he does here. He'll try to hang on and stay on the lead lap. You saw the leaders just coming in the frame there.
So Dale Earnhardt Jr. continuing on his way. Matt Kenseth and Randy LaJoie. Those two fellas are now up by 2 seconds on third place Jeff Green. He got all those lap machines before the 32 comes into view, along with Keller and McLaughlin. Take a look again what happened, Larry. Maybe we can see what, if anything, what caused Earnhardt Jr. to spin.
This is coming off turn four here. See, just a bunch of traffic. I don't know if somebody got into him. That looks like maybe the 36 of Ken Fevito, well, that was behind him. I don't know if they got into him, or maybe he just got loose up off turn four. Chances are he might have got a little bit of help with that.
I dare say we'll find out a bit later on when we talk to those involved. Earnhardt Jr. in 17th right now. Still on the lead lap, but he's a goodly distance back. He's 15 seconds back, so he's roughly 5 seconds from being last.
But I tell you, just looking at NASCAR scoring, his speeds, evidently he didn't hurt that set of tires. I don't, he have no traffic to contend with, neither does race leader Randy LaJoie. But his speeds is right there real close to Randy LaJoie. So what he needs him a caution here shortly where he can catch back up and make up that distance.
Randy LaJoie took the lead most recently in lap 101. Further back, some good battles going on. The 90, Brad Loney. The 98, Elton Sawyer. That's for position. That's for 7th and 8th. Elton won here in 1994. He's just going to try the outside on Loney if he can make it stick. Ooh! Just about in the wall that time for Buckshot Jones. See that?
It was an awfully close call there. Just about gathered the wall up. This is a good run for Brad Loney. 7th position there, and good run for all these guys. Nathan Butkin on.
The 93, he's a lap down, Dave Blaney is. He's running in 22nd spot. That's a good battle there. 90 Loney, 98 Elton Sawyer. Just ahead of them, you see that at the back of that red car, the 89, that's Nathan Butkin. He, too, is in that battle for position. That's 6th, 7th, and 8th. Behind them, Phil Parsons is running 9th, and Jeff Purvis is 10th. Todd Bodine is up to 11th. A lot of guys making some moves. They all desperately needed that caution.
Yes, they did.
What it was.
Just looking again at the 93 car, Dave Blaney, they just don't have the handle on that car. It's like he can't get it down in the corners. Car looks a little bit loose up off. He wins the battle getting down in the corner, but right there pays the price up off the corner, just not gripping the racetrack. Look at this battle here for second. This is Jeff Green again coming all the way from 29th starting position.
Riding with Jeff inside of Kenseth.
Boy, he's Look running that car right around the bottom.
I mean, really, the apron is just a track extension for him.
His car just working there, and with ease, he takes over the second position here on lap 122, just three laps shy of the halfway point.
So the battles continue behind Randy LaJoy. The Bob Evans crews do what we all do. Log on to NASCAR Online before, during, after the races, anytime during the week. It is a font of information. NASCAR's 24-hour garage pass, if you will. NASCAR Online at NASCAR.com. That's where you can find them on the World Wide Web.
See that sight right there, Eli?
Yep.
Little Lee just went a lap down again. Evidently, the handling just not where he wants it on that car. There you see, not keeping it down like Randy LaJoy. And Randy LaJoy leading the race, putting back a lap down. So he fought to get that lap back. I'm sure the spin was a big part of losing this lap again.
Lyndon Amick, you know the story, climbed out of the car after the race at Dover, but he's back for this event at Indianapolis Raceway Park. Mike Bliss has been in the car the last couple of races. Elliott Sadler is going to drive that car later in the season. Riding with Todd Bodine, he's up to ninth now. Good solid run for the Phillips 66 team.
Yes, he is. Running here, he's moved up to ninth position, so he's just, you know, starting a little bit back in the field. He's just trying to hang on this lead lap and keep going here as the night goes on. Work his way forward.
He's done well on the Busch Series short tracks this year. Finished fifth at Nashville.
He's definitely had what you might call a roller coaster season. Yeah. It's been up and it's been down.
Short tracks have been good, though. He's also fifth at Bristol, fourth at Richmond, 12th at South Boston. So the short track program, as he skated it there off the turn.
That's what you call, again, lack of forward bite. Yep. When you see those hands go back to the right, you know those rear tires aren't gripped.
That's Twister, the car that Todd was driving. You see Ricky Hendrick there in the picture, the 24. He's in 22nd spot, couple of laps down now. 89, Nathan Butke. He's running on the lead lap in 12th. Further behind those guys, the 53, that yellow car with the blue hood, that's Hank Parker Jr. He's on the lead lap in 13th spot, having a super run. There's Hank. His season pretty well turned at South Boston, remember?
Yes, it did. He was in position to win that race. I think he ended up, was it third he ended up there? If those two guys had got together, he'd have been right there to have won that race.
He's doing well. Justin Labonte running in 14th. Tony Roper running in 15th. The 74, Rames, not on the lead lap. He's in 23rd, a couple of laps down. But remember, he's leading the Rookie of the Year points. Tony Rames is. And the guy who is second in rookie points, Adam Petty, failed to qualify. So this is going to be an opportunity for Rames, regardless of where he finishes, to pad his lead some more. 53, Hank Parker Jr., he's third in Rookie of the Year point standings, but some 289 behind Rames. 36, Tim Fedewa spun back at lap 102. Last year's pole sitter is back in 32nd, four laps down. Interesting names to talk about today, but that's the most interesting story. Randy LaJoy, the leader, about to lap 15th place Tony Roper. Hey, folks, remember, when we move aside, Saturday night at the races continues, one of the biggest sprint car races of the year. What do you think a bunch of outlaws are going to do for $50,000? Well, you can find out next. The Pennzoil World of Outlaws battling in the Mopar Kings Royal. That's coming up on Saturday night at the races. Steve Evans, Brad Doty, and the crew standing by, and they'll be on the air as soon as we move aside from here at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. Randy LaJoy is the leader, but that's one of the great stories right now. That is Brad Loney running in fifth spot, Glenn, and what a job he's doing tonight.
Oh, Eli, this is an amazing job by Brad Loney. It's only his 11th start this year, and his best finish was 10th at Daytona in his very first start. So he's moved all the way up to fifth from 21st starting position. Now, one of the reasons for his success is his crew chief. It's none other than Bob Johnson. Bob Johnson has been around the sport forever. I'm going to talk to him real quickly here. Bob, you've got a lot of experience. You came into NASCAR with the Race Hill Farms people, but you got to really be excited about the way Brad's running right now.
He's doing a heck of a job here, I'll tell you, for his first time here. Just hang on here till the next stop and see how it shakes out. That's all.
Any changes planned for the car?
No, we didn't do anything the last stop, and right now we seem to be working pretty good, so we'll see what happens.
Well, I'd say pretty good is an understatement, guys. He is quickly gaining on Matt Kenseth, who is running fourth. I tell you, Bob Johnson, as I said, came into the sport as Harry Gant's crew chief, Ron Bouchard, back to the old Race Hill Farms car that Jack Beebe owned. He's been around ever since, but I tell you, he's got these boys shining tonight.
And remember, too, folks, that Loney, remember, he got hurt at Nazareth. He was banged up during the race in Charlotte. Didn't qualify at Dover, so not only is he still getting experience, some of the races he could have run, he had to miss because of injuries this year.
But boy, I really didn't know that Bob Johnson was his crew chief.
Yeah.
That's great to see. I'm glad to see this kind of a run for Brad Loney, but I'm glad to see it for Bob Johnson. Bob been around a ton of years, has kind of jumped around a few teams here over the past few years, and this is good to see. You could see that smile on Bob Johnson's face as he was talking.
Some of the best race runs at Junie Donlevy's bunch had at NASCAR Winston Cup was with Bob Johnson as crew chief. You see the leader, Randy LaJoy, he's working race traffic. Just put Justin Labonte a lap down in the 44. Justin's done a great job staying on the lead lap. He's closing in on the 40. That's Butch Miller in the 40 car, the current driver there. Only the second time he's running the NASCAR Busch Series here. Speaking of the old driver, though, remember Stanton Barrett. He drove that car earlier this year, and he's been doing some testing over the last few days with Junie Donlevy's bunch. So
yeah.
A lot of folks finding opportunities elsewhere.
And looking at these young drivers, that seems to be the thing that's going on here right now. There you see Randall George pulling beside the 40 car going down the backstretch. I tell you, Mark Reno, those guys with the James Finch team, this one car, they have got this car hooked up. I talked to Randy today a little bit, just about Myrtle Beach in general, about his race car and what was going on. And even though he was with a different race team, everything different a year ago when he won this race, he said, Larry, pretty much the setup's about the same. So it's not like this racetrack has changed a lot in a year, and Randy LaJoy is kind of showing that here tonight.
We're just 13 laps away from the next competition caution. There's Todd Bodine in the 66. He's running in seventh spot right now.
This is where I tell you, these drivers, especially these top drivers that's in contention for this win, this is where they've got to give their crew chief good information right now, because this is going to be the last chance coming up here at lap 170 in about 10 or 12 laps to make the final adjustments on these race cars. Give it the best set of tires you can, fill it up with fuel, and make those adjustments. And pretty much from then, it's pretty much the driver in the car for those last 80-something laps.
These guys here all battling for position. Elton Sawyer, 98, 66, Todd Bodine, 43, Shane Hall, all battling for position. That is 6th, 7th, and 8th right there with 6th place up for grabs. Jimmy Foster has just taken his car behind the wall at lap 153 for him. He was 7 laps behind the leaders. Here's a great battle right there. Give it to Todd Bodine. He'll grab the 6th spot. But all the while, Randy LaJoy continues to lead. But the edge on Jeff Green now, less than a second.
Duralube advanced
there front and center has just grabbed 6th away from Todd Bodine here at lap number 164. That's the Kerry Agajanian Mike Curb car. And caution, turn number three. Caution on the speedway. Dale Earnhardt Jr., who had just gone a second lap down, has problems while running in 24th spot. So Dale Earnhardt Jr. brings out caution for the third time tonight. Lap 165 officially. And Larry Mack, he must have flat spotted the tires in the first place when he spun there earlier, because when he went, remember how long it took to go a lap down, then he went a second lap down like in no time.
Exactly, and you could see the right front tires flat there. You see sparks. Now what's probably happening here is the sway bar arm is underneath there. With that tire riding around like that, he's probably dragging the sway bar off, and this car is going to really be a handful. He really needs to get that thing in the pits, or he's not going to have anything on that right front left. But yeah, you got to believe, we started hearing reports he was feeling a vibration under that spin. We talked about it, flat spot in those tires, and he's got to get that thing to pit road, or they're really going to have a mess to contend with.
Man, I'll tell you, this is going to be something to see, because the point lead was only 139 over Matt Kenseth. And look at that, at this very moment, it is only 61 points, because Kenseth is running in fourth. So this could be a major spot in the standings of this season when you look back over 1999.
Well, one race can really make a difference.
Say, last couple of weeks have not been beauties for that boy. Remember last week in New Hampshire in the NASCAR Winston Cup race, he finished 43rd, only completed, 44 laps before the ignition went out. Watch what happened here. The tire.
Yeah, this is over in turn three and turn four. There you see some, just looks like tire come off it right there. So evidently that tire started coming apart right there. And evidently a little bit further down the racetrack is when it deflated and the air went out of it.
So caution on the speedway for Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s problems at lap number 165. It has been such a very clean race. Tim Feeder was spun at lap 102, brought out a caution. Dale Earnhardt Jr. spun earlier, but there was no caution. And now spins again at lap 165. So LaJoy, Green, Keller, Kenseth, Loney, Shane Hall, your top six. Then Todd Bodine, Elton Sawyer, Mike McLaughlin, Phil Parsons. That is your top 10. Now, Mike Hogwood, I believe the Urys have some handfuls of work to do right here.
They do, Eli. And the big discussion with NASCAR officials has been whether we're under the competition yellow. We're not. And it looks like they're only going to be able to change that flat tire, which is on the right front. And while those discussions were going on, it was Dale Jr. He was staying out. And they're also going to obviously have to check underneath this car to see what they've torn up. Dale Jr. is into the pits, and they are just taking one tire out. That's all that NASCAR is allowing them to put on the car. It will go on the right front. They are looking underneath. The tire is bolted on. They are pulling some sheet metal away from the left front as a result of some of those spins there on the front straightaway. Not been a good night at all for Dale Earnhardt Jr. as the crew, Tony Urie Sr., is even out off the pit box, and he is down out taking a look at the car. A lot of frustrated looks here in the Dale Jr. pits, and there is really no rush to get things going, and that tire is a mess, as you can see, that came off that car.
And, of course, the reason that Mike brought up that this is not the competition caution, we've not even yet gotten to that lap. The caution was due at lap 170. We're now at lap 169, but the caution flew at lap 165. So we had not yet at that point reached the competition caution. Hey, folks, it is kind of warm here in Myrtle Beach tonight. That's the theme to what we've got going for you here on TNN this month. Hot summer nights month. Saturday night at the races on TNN Motorsports. The Tecumseh 300 coming up on Saturday, July 24th. That is the American Speed Association, the ASA, running in Salem, Indiana. And then on Saturday, July 31st, a big doubleheader. We'll be with you for the CarQuest Auto Parts 2. Continuing under the caution here, NASCAR verifying the correct positioning of some of the cars. You see the Buckshot Jones 00 not being penalized. He is merely being placed back into the correct running order on the racetrack. And everybody getting themselves positioned as we have now reached lap number 170, where the next competition caution is due.
You know, I can kind of see why Tony Urey and them maybe was questioning whether this could lead into the competition caution, because again, this was all going on lap 166 to 168. They didn't want to bring him in because we saw him sitting there changing that right front tire, because this is a short track, 35 miles an hour down pit road. He lost another lap while he was in there. So yeah. I could see why they was questioning, is this the competition caution?
Tony Urey there in the beard. And now here is the competition caution. We have now gotten to the completion of lap 170, the start of lap 171. So this is the continuation of the first caution, but at the same time, Glenn, it's a different segment of this caution.
Yeah, Eli, that's a great way to explain it, because I was pretty confused down here about exactly what was going on, but I knew you'd straighten it out for me. LaJoy comes in. They're not going to make any changes. The only thing that Randy has asked for is four tires, fuel, peel the piece off the windshield, the tearaway strip, and give him some water. He's a little thirsty. Other than that, everything's set to go here. No changes. Mike Hargood, what you got?
Well, Matt Kenseth, as we said, did not like that set of tires, so obviously they're going to make some wedge adjustments. They make some big air pressure adjustments into that car. Same story for Jeff Green. One car at this end to watch out for in this last run is going to be Todd Bodine. He started off really bad. The rear end was hopping on the 66 car. They've got that fixed now. Todd had one simple word to his crew chief, Donnie Richardson. He said, give me some more grip. Let's go. And they've made a shock adjustment and an air pressure adjustment on the 66. They should be good here in this last run.
So final changes taking place here at the Myrtle Beach Speedway in front of a sold-out crowd of 17,000. We're back on TNT. Beach Speedway alongside Larry McReynolds with Glenn Jarrett and Mike Hockwood. I'm Eli Gold. We are wrapping up the second of the two competition caution periods here with Randy LaJoy leading Jeff Green and Jason Keller. That's your top three. Now we've got time for the AutoZone Tech Fact, brought to you by the more than 2,500 AutoZone stores across America. AutoZone, the best parts in auto parts. Here's Glenn.
Thanks, Eli. You know, one of the first things that you worry about when you come to Myrtle Beach, whether it's you going to a restaurant wondering how cool it is, me going to a golf course wondering how hot it is in the golf course, or these guys at the racetrack, or the people at the beach, heat and humidity is always high here, and so these guys got to do whatever they can to try to take care of that heat. Randy LaJoy, who's leading the race, evidently has done a good job. They're using in their car this elaborate system that you're looking at inside this car here. It's called a cool box. Now, it's kind of a misnomer. There's no coolant of any kind, no ice, no Freon, no anything in there to cool this. Simply, they force air across some aluminum blades that cools the air. Now, something aerospace technology I don't know about, but all I do know is it works. Randy says right now it's about 15 to 20 degrees cooler in his car than he's ever had it before. This is the first time he's used it. And, Larry, I think you guys use something like this. You can probably tell us more.
Yeah, we use it with Mike Skinner, and we first started using it way back in the mid-90s with Ernie Irvin in the 28 car. It takes air from the outside, runs it across some coils. All it takes, there's no Freon, there's no ice, there's no gases, a little bit of electrical draw from your electrical system, and you blow the air in the helmet and blows cool air on them. And you can even go to different cooling temperatures. I think there's two or three different settings, so if you're too cold, you cut it down just a little bit and not get quite as cold air in on you.
Amazing, the technology. The field had gotten the one to go signal, but now they're putting the caution flag out. We're going to have one more lap. By the way, the guy that we've been talking about, Randy LaJoy, and with whom we're riding right there, yesterday, while so many folks were out of their riding their Harleys or on the beach or whatever, Randy took some time out to visit the children's unit of the Grand Strand Regional Medical Center here yesterday, and kind of tip our hats to all these guys. A lot of stuff that they, I said, oh, we'll talk about it on the air. He goes, I'm not really looking for publicity, but you know, it's kind of nice to see these guys take vacation time. He's down here with his wife and all, and they just took some time away and went to visit the kids in the hospital.
Oh, I mean, that's great, and I mean, that's the way it is. The Winston Cup drivers, the Busch Grand National drivers, the Truck Series drivers, they all, it's just, it never gets publicized, and that's not the reason they do it.
Yeah.
How much work they do like this and going and putting a smile on a little kid's face that's in a hospital or something with some sort of illness.
Nothing like it. Glenn, you had a final thought?
Yeah, James Finch, the car owner for Randy LaJoy, heard me talking about all, and he came up to me when I threw it back to you, Larry and Eli, and he said, what's the big deal? I said, all Chevrolet Monte Carlos come with air conditioning.
Leave it to Larry Finch to bring it down to the basics for us. All right, folks, here we go. We're still at lap 171. Remember, these caution laps do not count. Here we go. Green in the air. 271 of 250.
Two laps down. There you see Jeff Green, the second place car, the 32 car, all over the back bumper.
Just a half second back, the 32 and the 57 Keller, teammate to Jeff Green, remember. Matt Kenseth running in fourth, Brad Loney fifth, Shane Hall is sixth, Todd Bodine is seventh, and Elton Sawyer in eighth. Ninth is Mike McLaughlin and Phil Parsons 10th, but Mike, Todd's doing a strong job now.
Oh, he really is, and they've got a little problem. They have lost radio communications with their spotter. So what's had to happen is that crew chief Donnie Richardson's climbed up on top of the transporter, and he's having to play the role of spotter to help Todd Bodine get around this racetrack. A little handicap here for the 66 team.
That's really got to be a handicap because, again, the spotter just is such an important part of this. You know, looking for trouble on the racetrack, and things happen so fast here at a racetrack like Myrtle Beach Speedway, but also in the late stages of the race running as good as they are, he's the one saying, hey, clear low, clear high, somebody coming up on your rear bumper. He's a big part of that race car, and that's got to be a big deficit losing communication.
Tough, tough break for Tony Roper, who was running in 15th on the restart. He was black flagged for jumping the restart and has just come down the pit lane for a stop-and-go penalty. Oh, a heartbreaker right there for a young man who had himself a fine run going. Tony tested here last Tuesday and Wednesday and was doing well, but now has to make that unscheduled pit stop for the stop and go. Winding down towards the finish. The 1, the 32, the 57, all running in position. That's first, second, and third.
The 32 and the 57. We mentioned earlier, team cars. Jason Keller, his car looks like a little bit better right there. Pulls right up on the bumper of teammate Jeff Green. They come down the front straightaway.
Matt Kenseth running in fourth. Hal Goodson parks his car. Engine failure for the favorite in these parts. He's from the Darlington area, not far up the road. Engine failure putting Goodson behind the wall, along with Jimmy Foster and DJ Holzel. First-time starter for Holzel in the NASCAR Busch Series. Those are the only three retirees. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is three laps down and 30th, if you're just joining us. A myriad of problems for that AC Delco car today.
Looking out the back bumper of Jeff Green's car toward his teammate.
There's Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the three. He's had a lot of races on this track over the years. Has not had spectacular runs. But he's been solid. Always brought his car back in one piece and was always second or third in points here in late model stock car competition. Up front, Randy LaJoy. Still showing the way, but by only that little margin. That blue Monte Carlo is Jeff Green, just two car lengths behind. Back, everybody, to the Myrtle Beach Speedway, where we are under caution. That's Hermie Sadler's car. Hermie is going to be driving the number 33 for 10 races here in 1999. But Hermie had problems moments ago, came spinning off turn number four. And let's take a look at what happened. It was not all easily cut and dry here.
This was over in turn four. There you see Phil Parsons getting a little tap from Mike McLaughlin, getting sideways, almost spinning, gathers it back up as he comes on the front straightaway.
Then behind him, everybody else was getting on the binders, and there was where Hermie spun around and crunches it there up against the inside retaining wall for the fourth caution flag of the day. By the way, if you're a basketball fan, you are astute to question, since when does the former University of Memphis or Memphis State star Larry Finch have a car in the race? He, of course, does not. James Finch does.
Okay.
And we were talking about him earlier, and I guess I called him Larry, who I've known for years as a standout basketballer, but you never know. Hey, more and more athletes are showing up, and Jackie Joyner, Kersey now.
Boy, Eli, that's about as good a job as I've seen dancing around that as I've ever seen.
Field is going to get the one-to-go signal. Thank you very much, Larry Mack. When we come back, Green getting set to go back to green at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. Randy LaJoy still leads him. Lap 189 of 250. Jeff Green's in second.
Both of them have cleared the lap traffic now of Tony Raines.
Raines is in that pack number 74. He's at 19th, three laps down. 17 is Kenseth. He's running fourth. The 57 is Keller. He's just getting around Raines now. So again, the front three all tied together. Tony Roper, by the way, has been waved around the pace car. It happened during the caution flag. After further review, he was given back the lap that he was penalized earlier. So Tony Roper still, at this stage, having himself a good day. He's running in 18th position with that lap having been reinstated, and that's the battle for second.
This is a good battle, Eli. I've been watching Jason Keller, Jeff Green. There you see him going into turn one. Jason Keller gets the preferred line. That's where Jeff Green's been running that race car. This is coming off of turn two, side by side up the back straightaway.
This is a second behind the leader, LaJoy.
Clear for second place as they go down the front straightaway.
Keller, who's in second, led laps 8 through 43. LaJoy, meanwhile, has led 112 laps here tonight. Remember before, the guys were going 94, 95 miles an hour when the tires were fresh. Now with the goody having been rubbed off the tires.
You liked that, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. That will be a nice new McReynolds-ism.
There you go.
See how the speeds are dropping down just a little bit. Now let's see what Jason Keller can do.
Well, once he cleared his teammate, yeah. Jeff Green, I mean, he is coming. I'm sure Randall Joy is looking up and saying, boy, this guy, he is coming in a hurry because he's running almost 1 mile an hour faster right now than the leader, Randy LaJoy.
Jason Keller right there in the 57. He is sixth in points now. 91 points behind the number 5 point man, Elton Sawyer.
Really reeling Randy LaJoy in here.
Jason's win came at Bristol. Another short track, but certainly far different than this one. High banked half mile, 36 degrees of banking. There's the battle now for fourth and fifth. Kenseth in the 17, Loney in the 90. Brad Loney doing himself proud. We had talked about him earlier. Doing himself a super job. There you see the battle for the lead now. Keller having caught LaJoy.
Randy LaJoy. Randy gets a little bit high there. Coming off turn four.
Might be the opening.
Pulls to the inside.
For the lead, give it to Keller. So Keller takes over at lap 199. Hasn't led since lap 43.
Right there looked like where Randy has been losing it. Right there, just up off the corner. Looks like that's where Jason's really been pulling it.
Oh, slowing down on the racetrack, the 83 of Wayne Grubb. Wayne's running back in 26th, a couple of laps down.
You see the red light there shining on the top of his dash. A lot of times what that is an oil pressure light, which is signs that this is probably a terminal problem, no oil pressure. You see it shining right there? That's not a good sign. That shows you that you probably got big problems.
He is one of the handful of drivers pitting on the back straightaway here at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. Pits were assigned on the basis of points because you have the competition cautions and picking the pit position. position of your choice not quite as critical under those circumstances. So he, along with Ricky Hendrick there in the 24, who's still running in 20th, by the way, only a couple of laps down, doing himself proud. Those are just some of the fellas who are pitting on the back straightaway. Jimmy Foster is called to tonight, overheating. So four drivers out of the event. Looks like somebody took a bit of a can opener to the right rear of the Justin Labonte car.
Boy, I tell you, you talk about doing yourself proud. He's running in 14th position, yeah. Just, one lap down right now. So he's really doing himself proud as well. Look, the battle for second place heating up here between Randall LaJoie and Jeff Green.
Meanwhile, Mike Hogwood, he's out by a second now, the leader Keller is.
And Jason Keller is feeling great in the car. Just told him it was crew chief Steve Addington. He said, you know, that last adjustment, it was only a half pound of air pressure that they took out of the car. He said, that last adjustment has this car right. We are ready to go. He can smell it here tonight in Myrtle Beach.
Looking for win number two of the year is Jason Keller. We're at lap 205. 45 laps yet to go at Myrtle Beach. Don't forget, folks, in the background, you can probably hear Steve Evans and Brad Doty clearing their throats even as we speak, because Saturday Night at the Races continues as soon as we move aside. One of the biggest sprint car races of the year, 50 grand up for grabs. The Pennzoil World of Outlaws battling in the Mopar Kings Royal. That's coming up as soon as we move aside, as Saturday Night at the Races continues here on TNN Motorsports. Welcome back. We are live at the Myrtle Beach Speedway in South Carolina. That man was the leader earlier. Randy LaJoie, Glenn, has now backslid to third.
Yeah, Eli, and I'm not really sure what's going on. His lap times right now, he's the second fastest car on the racetrack. Only Jeff Green was running a lap quicker, but Randy on the radio a while ago came across and he was really frustrated and upset with himself. Evidently, he must have gotten out of his rhythm a little bit, started missing his line on the racetrack. Crew chief Mark Reno told him, Randy, just work hard, drive your line, you're okay. But it's kind of unusual. I've never really heard Randy get on himself like that, but he's a little bit frustrated right now. Hadn't said a word about how the car is handling.
Again, Randy won here last year, finished third here in 1997. As a crew chief, Larry Mack, do you have to ride drivers, and you've worked with a lot of top flight drivers, including Mike Skinner now. Sometimes do you have to be a philosopher and father confessor and all of this on the radio to keep everybody under control?
Oh, there's no question, because, you know, you're getting toward the end of the race. You got 35 laps to go. You feel like you've got a car that's good, but everybody's car is going to start sliding around. These tires give up, and sometime out of frustration, the driver loses his rhythm. And what you got to do, you got to stay on him. Hit your mark, get your rhythm. And it looks like he is maybe reeling Jeff Green back in here, the 32 cars. He pulls below Mike Dillon. But it's important to make that driver understand you still got plenty of laps to go. Get your rhythm back, hit your marks. Everything's going to be fine.
Hermie Sadler's back on the racetrack, by the way, after that spin of earlier. He's 37 laps down, but the crew did what work they could, and he's running in 32nd position. So Hermie's back out there. There you see him, the Bear car, just ahead of Jeff Green. Green, 1 LaJoie. They'll be battling for second, but they are 1 8-tenths seconds behind the leader, Jason Keller. Keller right now working his way through that pack of traffic you see near the upper portion of your screen.
That's going to be the key here, Eli, with 30 laps to go, you know, as far as Jason Keller leading the race, as far as Jeff Green and Randall LaJoie. If this thing should stay green without caution, it's going to be this lap traffic. It could play a role in what happens here.
Around Lyndon Amick goes our race leader.
Randy does look like maybe he lost his rhythm and now he's kind of getting it back. The car don't look like it's near as upset. A while ago, we watched him through the windshield coming off turn four. There you see right there, watching his hands. A while ago, he was yanking the car around, and that's a sign maybe he kind of got out of his rhythm, but he looks really smooth here. As you see his right hand up on the steering wheel.
Glenn Jarrett, I know you've raced here in the past. What happens when a driver loses his rhythm? Because obviously Randy LaJoy knows how to drive this track. What happens?
Well, Eli, when that happens, it's just like Larry says. You get frustrated, and then you start trying too hard. You know you've lost some valuable time on the racetrack, so you really start overdriving the car, kind of like Larry was talking about what Randy was doing. And you might get in the corner too hard, and then you try to pick up the throttle a little too soon, and that just makes things worse. That compounds it. That's exactly why the crew chief keeps coming on and saying, hey, just calm down, you know, go back to what you were doing. And I know that Larry will back this up, and anybody that's ever driven a race car, a lot of times, on a short track like this, particularly one that gets slick like Myrtle Beach does, the slower you go into the corners, a lot of times the quicker you can come off of them. So it's not a question of how fast you can or how hard you can drive it down in there. It's getting back in the throttle and making the car accelerate up off the corner. Now, I never really had a lot of experience here because the only time I came here, they didn't have a fence here. And in practice, after three laps, I went out in the parking lot and never came back. And I took the race car out there.
Did you find a spot to park?
I had a great spot. Nobody would come near me.
The 25-lap rule in effect now as we're inside of the final 25 circuits at the Myrtle Beach Speedway. We're going to take our final commercial break and then come back to take you to the checkers as Jason Keller leads. Can he hang on to win it? Folks, you can race into the all-new and official store of NASCAR. Visit NASCAR Thunder, now open in cities all across the country for locations and all the information you might need. Just call that number you see on the screen. The number is operational Monday through Friday, and you'll be hooked up with the nearest NASCAR Thunder store to you. We are live at the Myrtle Beach Speedway watching that man who went to Clemson University, Jason Keller, trying to notch another victory. He won at Indianapolis Raceway Park in 95, won at Bristol, as we said earlier this year. On the racetrack at Barrier, stops off the corner, then continues on his way. No caution flag. We stay under the green. Don't forget, if you're tuning in, to watch the Pennzoil World of Outlaws. It's coming your way as soon as we move aside. Steve Evans and Brad Doty at the Kings Royal from Eldora. That's coming up right after the Myrtle Beach 250. Jason Keller from Greenville, South Carolina. Graduate of the NASCAR Slim Jim All-Pro Series. Had 5 wins in that NASCAR Touring Series.
Well, I tell you, there's one person that don't want to see a caution, like, for instance, when Ed Berry had a problem a while ago, and that's Jason Keller. I think he's strong enough to hold these two guys here off, the 32 of Jeff Green and the one of Brandon LaJoy, but I'm sure he's more comfortable out there where he's at right
now. I would think by 2.6 seconds. This could be a pretty good battle right here, though. Green just ahead of LaJoy for second spot. They have left Matt Kenseth by 3.5 seconds. Kenseth is running in fourth, and if you're just tuning in, Dale Earnhardt Jr. is 4 laps down and 26th. So his rather comfortable lead atop the NASCAR Busch Series, which was 139 points, will dwindle to around 70 points or so if nothing changes here. There's Kenseth running in fourth, 6 seconds behind the leader. Shane Hall, spectacular run tonight in fifth. Brad Loney, great job in sixth. And Todd Bodine, Elton Sawyer, Phil Parsons, Jeff Purvis, your top 10.
These two guys just pretty equal right now. You saw Randy run up on him a while ago, then feathered back just a little bit. You see Randy really beats him getting down in the corner through 3 and 4 there, but Jeff Green seems to pull him up off the corner coming off there on the front straightaway.
Jason Keller started outside of the front row. He's the race leader while we watch this battle for second.
Randy really pulling up on his rear bumper right there as they come off turn 4. You know, Randy faded just a little bit. Maybe what he was doing, cooling his tires just a little bit. Maybe trying to get one more run on him before this thing ends.
It'll be five to go as you see the countdown there on the upper left of the screen. And they get back to the stripe. Keller is up by 1 9/10. There he is, right behind Purvis. Keller in the 57. Look at the crew in the insert there on your screen.
Whoa, Phil Parsons getting sideways right in front of race leader Jason Keller. They don't need that right now.
Steve Addington and the crew probably had their hearts skip a beat right there.
I guarantee you Phil Parsons running in ninth position trying to hang on to the lead lap. He's put all but eight cars a lap down here with four laps to go, Eli.
Scary moment, but he's through that bit of traffic. And there's not too much more to have to deal with. He does have Elton Sawyer, a veteran racer, ahead of him by about a third of the straightaway. Look at Phil. He's going to try and get back on the lead lap. And there's Ricky Hendrick giving some room to LaJoy. Ricky Hendrick's in 20th still, three down.
Our leader's got problems. He's got
problems for Keller. Problems for Keller as everybody goes by with three to go. Problems for Jason Keller with three laps to go. This is like a New Hampshire all over again.
You all of a sudden, right as he went past Phil Parsons, you see smoke come out the exhaust.
Oh, look at that. Left rear tire.
Left rear tire flat.
Left rear is flat. The leader is the 32 Green. Jeff Green is the race leader in the 32. White flag is out. Jeff Green, who won at Nashville back in April and has two career wins. Maybe for him, this is his just due after losing one late in Milwaukee. Green will win here in Myrtle Beach. LaJoy settles for second, and it's a heartbreaker for Jason Keller, who has a flat tire with 2.5 laps to go. Mike Hogwood.
Well, we're waiting for Harold Holly to climb down off the pit box here, but this, as you can see, is one excited group. One excited team right here. Let me grab Harold over here. Harold, high five on his team. Congratulations on the win.
Yeah, bittersweet victory for you.
Yeah, I tell you what. After our qualifying effort today, I thought it was going to be a hard time, but we knew we had a good race car. We just had an early draw, and it showed, though. Jeff come back. I hate it for Jason because Jason had a good hot rod. I tell you what, this Progressive Motorsports team, I can't. Hot rods out there having a good time. But I tell you what, Clean X is doing an awesome job for us. This year's been so great. This team, we've been down a couple of times, but they keep digging. Every time they get knocked back, they dig back a little bit harder. I just want to give this to all the guys. They're great. I tell you what, it's the greatest team I've ever worked with. Jeff Green's the most awesome race car driver in the world.
Well, excitement down here, and certainly Jeff Green do the racing gods with him tonight.
Jeff Green has had himself some interesting finishes. He was second at Daytona this year. Then he won at Nashville. He was second at New Hampshire. He was second at South Boston. He was second at Milwaukee. He finished third in Texas. But now he's gotten himself another win, Larry Mack.
And I tell you, with the misfortunes of his teammate, Jason Keller, who just had an awesome race car, especially that last run, Jason comes home in eighth, but there you see the left rear tire completely flat. Jason trying to come in. The tire just finally come completely apart. But his teammate's there to cash in on the problem.
Sometimes this can just be a terribly ruthless business one go away with 2.5 laps to go. Jeff Green won in Las Vegas back in 1997. Earlier this year, he won in Nashville. A couple of weeks ago, he knew he had the Milwaukee race won, but it wasn't to be. Casey Atwood nudged him aside. But Glenn, here in Myrtle Beach, Jeff Green's got himself a W.
Yeah, he climbs up on the car and gives the post, tells the world he's number one, at least for tonight. And here we go with the, who started this stuff with the Coca-Cola? I don't need another one of these. Now, come here, Jeff Green. Now, a couple weeks ago in Milwaukee, I talked to you in Victory Lane. That didn't work out. Tonight, I thought I was going to talk to your teammate. Here I am talking to you. Congratulations. You had a great break there at the end. You had a good race car, but it took bad luck on Jason's part.
Yeah, I hate it for Jason. We was wanting to run one and two. I was wanting to win, but he had a great car there at the end. And our Kleenex Chevrolet was awesome all night. I messed up qualifying, had an early draw, and we didn't get a good qualifying spot, but man, this Kleenex Chevrolet paid off. And these guys made the right adjustments. Just need a little bit more up off the corner there at the end to keep with Jason, but hate it for him. God bless, man. This is a good one for last week, man. This pays off for us.
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr. had problems tonight. Now, you missed a race early in the year, but still you're running a strong third in the series, in the chase for the series title. You still got a shot at that thing, even though you missed a race.
Well, we do, Glenn. We're not going to give up to Homestead the last lap. We keep winning races. We get the most points, so that's why you win championships. That's what we're going to do.
Well, if anybody can do it, Jeff Green can do it. I tell you guys, he's been one of the most consistent performers in the NASCAR Busch Series over the last couple months.
We had given you some of those numbers before, and he came in 285 points down to Dale Earnhardt Jr. That margin will narrow up here at Myrtle Beach. We're back with the final numbers as TNN Motorsports continues. Welcome back, everybody. The victory lane celebration continues for Jeff Green. I'll tell you, over the last few weeks, Larry Mack, we've seen a little bit of everything.
Well, we really have. You know, you just look at the night's turn of events. And I'm going to give a call to Shane Hall. They're
great
coming
run.
Home fourth. Brad Loney, fifth place finish. And the big turn of events, Dale Earnhardt Jr. having problems all night, ends up 25th.
Other names, you see where they finished. Justin Labonte, a great run in 14th. There's where Earnhardt Jr. came home in 25th. All sorts of problems. Not a good night for Casey Atwood. He has to settle for 29th position. And there you see the drivers who went out and to the garage area fairly early in the day. Quick look at the point standings for the NASCAR Busch Series. Now it's only 62. The point spread had been 139 coming in. So Matt Kenseth, by finishing third, and Earnhardt Jr. in 25th, it narrows up a whole lot. Larry Mack, have a good run next weekend in Pocono. A thank you to Larry McReynolds, to Glenn Jarrett, and to Mike Hogwood. I'm Eli Gold, congratulating Jeff Green. The crew couldn't believe it, but yes, you're heading to victory lane. Don't forget, folks, coming up next, Steve Evans, Brad Doty, Pennzoil, World of Outlaws, the Mopar Kings Royal, next from Eldora. We'll see you next time.